We're in the middle of a mental health tsunami, and the reality is there's been no real innovation in medicinal drug discovery for psychiatric disorders in at least 50 years. Now think about that. In what other sphere would you accept that as the current standard of care?
Psychedelics are an incredibly promising class of drugs, and when combined with specialist psychotherapy, may represent the next big thing in psychiatry. We are still really in the very beginning phases of trying to understand what these treatment approaches will be good for, who they will be good for, and indeed how to do the treatment as best we can.
We need to try and identify as many possible new avenues for treatment as we can. Monash is ideally placed to be able to do that. Treatments that, for example, could cure people or very significantly modify the disease course, which means that people then no longer need to receive treatment, that would be a significantly major advance.
If we look at the progress that's been made in treatment for things like cardiovascular disease, diabetes, cancer, there's been incredible progress in the last two or three decades. However, that's not the case for mental health therapeutics. It's fundamentally important that we essentially have a shift in the therapeutics that are available to treat what is becoming essentially an endemic crisis of mental health in the 21st century.
As a society, we've done an incredible job in destigmatizing mental illness, but the elephant in the room, the Achilles heel, remains that we do not have a commensurate improvement or increase in the available medicines to treat such disorders. Already we're in a situation where at least one in five Australians are suffering from either a mood, an anxiety, or a substance use disorder in any 12-month period. And it's only getting worse with something like COVID.
Another curve that now needs to be flattened is the spike in people with mental health struggles.
Tonight on Four Corners, we investigate how our overburdened mental health system is failing those desperately seeking help.
In just a decade, the number of people seeking help from emergency departments has jumped by more than 60%.
The Productivity Commission has estimated that the cost of mental illness on the Australian economy is between $200 and $250 billion a year. That's one-tenth of our economy every year that we're paying. But the bigger price, of course, is in people's lives. Two-thirds of suicides in Australia relate to people with experience with mental illness. We know that people's quality of life with mental illness is really severely affected.
I'm a clinical psychologist and I specialise in trauma and PTSD particularly. PTSD can be extremely debilitating for police, military and first responders. It's often really horrific. The images that they're having, the memories that are playing out for them are incredibly graphic or incredibly distressing on a scale that's hard to imagine, I think, for those of us that haven't gone through those things. We know the rates of veterans and police members for suicide are high. They're much higher than the average population. We do see a lot of relationship breakdowns. Technically, people don't recover from PTSD, and the treatments that we have aren't as effective as we'd like, or they take too long. A lot of the drugs that are being used regularly are hardcore drugs. You know, they're antipsychotics that are incredibly sedating and have really difficult side effects. It's incredibly urgent that we find new treatments for these people.
Are we going to simply accept that the fate of so many people is going to be just surrendered to existing treatments that we know fundamentally don't work?
You want something that's fast onset, you want something that you only take for a short period of time, and you want something that will then facilitate non-medicinal psychotherapeutic support. And if you look at where the evidence already exists for that type of neuromedicine, it's in the psychedelic space. It's in substances like psilocybin, but also non-classical psychedelics like MDMA and even ketamine.
Psilocybin is the active ingredient in magic mushrooms. MDMA is often found in ecstasy, Psychedelic-assisted therapies were the next big thing in psychiatry through the 50s and 60s before the prohibitionist war that Nixon founded.
America's public enemy number one in the United States is drug abuse.
The field has re-emerged in the last 25 years, initially quite slowly, and then in the last few years exponentially.
We're talking about drugs that are thought of in a recreational sense that could be quite controversial in a public conversation.
These drugs are prohibited in Australia. They have a scheduling that means that they are not allowed to be used outside of a research context or compassionate use programs or certain kinds of training.
This is a contentious issue. We've seen in the past, right from the war on drugs, how that contention can actually prevent progress being made in an area for decades.
People would be very interested to know that actually these medicines are relatively safe compared to many of the drugs that we might be more familiar with. There's a lot of evidence that alcohol does significantly more harm.
It's important to note that psychedelic-assisted therapies in terms of showing adequate safety and efficacy are not in the bag. Psychedelic-assisted therapies in the modern era are showing some remarkable treatment effects. But there are still so many basic unanswered questions.
What we want to understand are the neural mechanisms of the psychedelic experience. We know quite a bit with quite a high confidence about how these compounds work in the brain at the molecular level. What we actually don't know much, and that's what we are trying to do in our lab and in our experiments, is to understand how they work at the level of brain regions and brain networks.
It's fundamentally important to us that not only we understand mechanistically how these medicines are exerting their effects, but can we design better versions of them in the future?
I'd like to be able to find out which type of psychedelic substance works best for which type of psychiatric disorder and then be able to come up with more tailored molecules to suit the patient. It's the missing piece in our society wellness puzzle.
There is a desperate need for new developments, new initiatives, new discoveries. The Neuromeds Discovery Centre at Monash is designed to address that particular need.
It'll be the world's first academic centre that addresses the entire supply chain issue from end to end in terms of discovering, developing, formulating and progressing into clinical trials novel classes of neuromedicine based around the psychedelic principle. Monash has a critical mass of pharmacologists, psychiatrists, psychologists, medicinal chemists and drug discovery researchers that can really take this to the next level.
Monash also has world-class clinical research facilities, and it's world-leading in terms of its ability to develop policy, enact social change, and behaviour change in terms of, well, how do we fundamentally shift the world in which we treat mental health?
The Turner Institute for Brain and Mental Health is very much a core component of the psychedelic research at Monash. We've been extremely fortunate to have the development of Brain Park as part of the Turner. The psychedelic trials are happening at Brain Park because of its unique capabilities. We have neuroimaging and different types of technologies that can look at how treatment can impact the brain.
In the lab that I've set up, we are really developing a long-term program of research and therapist training and looking at a whole range of questions from new issues that these treatment approaches can be applied to, better ways of supporting people to go through psychedelic treatments, how to sustain the change, what does continued care look like after psychedelic experience, how to equip a workforce to deliver this as a service in a post-prohibitionist world, and then also how to educate the wider public and professional community around what is, in many respects, a unique treatment approach.
The commonality that I see that psychedelic drugs and related substances like MDMA have is that they are consciousness-altering medicines that allow you to review difficult or traumatic experiences. They really do allow you to almost dissolve your sense of self, then reorganize your thoughts in a therapeutic manner.
People have these experiences over the course of just a few hours. They are often rated as among the most personally meaningful experiences of a person's life. And they're also very challenging.
The way I view it is it's like antibiotics for the mind. You want to give patients a medicine for a short period of time to ensure they stay off medicines for a long period of time.
The group of people around this initiative are genuinely excited. They know it's going to be a long haul. We know it's going to be hard, it's going to be a struggle, it might not go all to plan, but there's an awful lot at stake.
We could be literally saving lives if we can treat this in a more timely manner and even just have more hope to offer at the beginning of a course of treatment, then I think we can save lives.